Shalom Israel, this is Bishop Nathaniel. The Israelites have been scattered across the four corners of the earth, as prophesied in Deuteronomy, the 20th chapter. Here at Israel United in Christ, we need your help to recover the remnant of our people, teach them the gospel. Please help us, support us, and join or donate to the Booster Club today. Shalom.
Today's topic is called The Concept of Time. I should have went over this a long time ago. And so I'm going to, due to lack of time, I'm going to go over it. Try to not go too fast, but fast enough to catch up.
Yeah, switch mics.
Switch mics?
Yeah.
All right, let me get the mic. All right. So now let's get Ecclesiastes 5 and 10. Start with that. We're going to go into how to count days. Some of y'all in here, if some of your brothers in here just, you know, don't know what the hell's going on in terms of days, so I'm gonna help you out. Sirach 5 and 10, we'll go there first. Who's reading?
I am, sir.
Sorry, okay, thanks. Let's go.
The book of Sirach, chapter 5, verse 10. Be steadfast in thy understanding.
So the first thing you must do is be steadfast in your understanding. Real quick, give me the definition of steadfast. Real quick, the definition of steadfast. Read again. You have the definition of steadfast up there? Read again.
Be steadfast in thy understanding.
Uh-huh.
And let thy word be the same.
Read it one more time. Sorry. Read again.
Be steadfast in thy understanding.
So it says, be steadfast in your understanding. And what else? What does it say?
And let thy word be the same.
And let your word be the same. Steadfast is spelled either with a E-A-D or E-D. Same thing. Okay. Steadfast. It says resolutely or dutifully, firm and unwavering. Synonyms are loyal, faithful, committed, devoted, dedicated, dependable, reliable, steady, true, constant, staunch, solid, trusty, click more, please. Trusty, firm, determined, resolute, relentless, implacable, single-minded, unchanging, unwavering, unhesitating, unfaltering, unswerving, unyielding, unflinching, uncompromising. So your understanding must be all of that there. All of that. But when you leave out of here, you become the antonym. You become disloyal and irresolute. A delinquent. Well, that's my last class. I'll go over that again. Loyal, faithful, committed. So your understanding must be, you must be firm in what you believe. You cannot be in here and be unwavering. I don't know. I'm not sure. I'm confused and just sit here looking stupid. And I know what's going on. So this class is going up. This class is geared towards helping your minds become steadfast when it comes to how you keep your feast days. Everyone understand how to keep Christmas. Everyone understand how to keep their birthday. We don't understand how to keep the feast days of the Lord. Right. So we're going to learn tonight. Read again.
Be steadfast in thy understanding, and let thy word be the same.
Let your word be the same. So when you understand, your mind is unwavering, it's firm, it's determined. When you're teaching, your teaching is the same as your understanding. It's firm, it's solid, unwavering, no compromise, no 50-50, no meet me halfway. It's firm, it's unwavering, uncompromising. That's what your understanding is supposed to be. You understand? Let's get Genesis 1 now. I'm going to go to the very beginning on how to count, deal with days, how to deal with time.
Right. So listen, when it says your understanding should be unwavering, meaning there's no such thing as debate.
Right.
Okay? It should be no such thing as debate. Okay? Or because if you debate with somebody, that means, you know, you're trying to see, you are comparing doctrines. There's no such thing as debate. You understand?
Read that, Genesis 1, we're going to read to verse 5.
Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth.
Uh-huh.
And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep.
I'm going to go through this. This is referring to deep space. Darkness upon the face of the deep. That's why Esau calls it deep space. This is outer space he's talking about. Go ahead.
And the Spirit of God moved and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters.
In space, because in outer space, there's water. That's water. That's why you take the helmet off, what happens to the man? If you're in outer space and the helmet comes off, what happens to the person? Who knows? They freeze. Why? Because it's cold. You understand? That's why astronauts, whenever they train to go into space, what do? They have them in a pool. Mm-hmm. Training underwater, because that's where they're going to go when they get up there. Underwater or outer water. I don't even want to call it. You understand? Outer water, underwater, inner water, sense of water, whatever. It's space, it's water up there. You understand? That's why astronauts train in water before they go up there, because they're in outer space and they're in water. They even move like it when they're in space. They move around, swim around, all that stuff, because there's water up there. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of those waters during creation. Go ahead.
And God said, let there be light.
So at this point, it was darkness, and the Lord said, okay, it's dark. Let me make light. Go ahead.
And there was light.
And he made light. Go ahead.
And God.
So what came first? Darkness came first. You understand so far?
Yes, sir.
Darkness came first. Go ahead.
And God saw the light that it was good.
This looks good. Go ahead.
And God divided the light from the darkness.
And so, like, if you open, turn a flashlight on in a dark room, it's separated. You have the light in one in there, and the darkness all around it. It's separate. Can't be one and the same. Can't mix it together. It's two separate things. So light divided from darkness. Go ahead.
And God called the light day.
So he called what he made light, he called it, you're going to call that day. We'll call it day. Go ahead.
And the darkness he called night.
And this, what we see at nighttime when the sun is gone, we see space, that's called night. You understand?
Yes, sir.
Darkness is called night. The light he made is called day. Go ahead.
And the evening and the morning were the first day.
And the evening, which is the darkness, which came first, and the morning, which came after, is what?
Were the first day.
First day. Y'all understand so far? Were the first day. So evening came first, then light came, then light ended. That started what? The next day. Now this is the Most High's time. The Most High gave it to Moses, so we can understand it in how I put it, in human terms. Because how the Most High did things is different. It's not, he's just letting us know in man's concept of time, how he did things. Because in man's time, this will take thousands of years. That's never. Should I do it? Yeah, get 2 Peter 3 and 8. Just get it real quick. Real quick, 2 Peter 3 and 8, just to explain what that means. It's referring to a day.
2 Peter chapter 3, verse 8.
Yeah.
But, beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing.
Uh-huh.
That one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years.
So, 1,000 years gone by for the Lord is a day. So his concept of a day is 1,000 years and gone by. Our concept of 1,000 years is 1,000 years. That's not a day for us.
Right.
That's millennia. That's thousands of years. So the Most High's way of time is different from ours. So he's giving Moses an understanding in human time what the day transpired, how his time of creation transpired. You understand? So he said, okay, that right there you'll count as one day. You'll count that as one day, and so on and so forth. Y'all understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
All right. Read again.
But, beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing.
Go ahead.
That one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day.
1,000 years as one day. Hold on a second. I have something else. My old Bible. Wait a second. I'm going to go there. Go back. Genesis 1 again. Read verse 5 again.
Genesis chapter 1, verse 5.
And now, this class is going to be hard. I'm going to show you straight up right now while we're in the beginning of it. It's going to be hard because some of y'all don't pay attention. Some of y'all being here just looking at my face and not paying attention. So I'm going to say it to you again. This class is going to be hard. Pay attention. Because that's why y'all end up not following the scripture earlier where it says be steadfast. Y'all don't be studying. Y'all be lost all the time. So I need y'all to focus and pay close attention. All right? Read again verse 5.
Verse 5. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night.
So darkness is called night, and light he called day. Go ahead.
And the evening and the morning were the first day.
Evening and the morning were the first day. And evening and the morning was written there. It's never ever changed. It was always there. Evening and the morning were the first day. Verse 8.
And God called the firmament heaven.
Called the sky, firmament, heaven. Go ahead.
And the evening and the morning were the second day.
I'm just flying through it. Verse 13. So evening in the morning, evening in the morning, evening in the morning, second day. Go ahead.
And the evening and the morning were the third day.
Hold on. Verse 13.
Verse 13. And the evening and the morning were the third day.
19.
Verse 19. And the evening and the morning were the fourth day.
Evening and the morning is fourth day. Jump to verse 23.
Verse 23. And the evening and the morning were the fifth day.
Evening and the morning again is the fifth day. Go to verse 31.
Verse 31. And to every beast, and God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day.
Sixth day. Genesis 2, verse 1 now.
Genesis chapter 2, verse 1. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them.
Chapter 2 takes place after chapter 1. It's one long letter. Go ahead.
And on the seventh day, God ended his work, which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made.
All right. Oh, hold on. So that's the seventh day. So the seventh day. Go ahead. Read down.
Okay. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it.
Uh-huh. Separated from all the other days. Go ahead.
Because that in it he had rested from all his work which God created and made.
So at this point, he rested. Seventh day, he rested. So this day was separate from all the other six. So this day will be hallowed. This day is separate from all the rest. I rested on this day. This day is special. So the six days are regular. The seventh day is a special day of rest for everyone and everything. Y'all understand?
Yes, sir.
All right. That's the seventh day or Sabbath day. Get Zonovan now. You got that? Did you do it for me? Zonovan Bible Dictionary. We're going to go to calendar. All right. Calendar. Let me see what I wanted. 7 day week. No, need number two, Ozias. Need number two. Go back. The 7 day week is of Semitic. I want that.
The seven day week is of Semitic origin.
Right. The 7 day week is of Semitic origin because the Semites maintained it primarily. Go ahead.
Egyptians had a week of 10 days.
And at certain points in time, the Egyptians had a week of 10 days. And they changed it, but it was originally 10 days for them. That's the Hamite weekly origin. The Hamites had, Semites or Shemites had a 7 day week. Ham maintained at certain points in time, he maintained a 10 day week. You understand? So when Israel was in Egypt, we didn't have a 7 day week with them. We had a 10 day week with them. You understand? Go ahead, read on.
The Jewish week had
the what? The what?
The Jewish week.
Because the Israelites derived from Shem. We are Shemite. Everyone in here is a Shemite. Oh, Lord's will, hopefully. Some of y'all here might be the Edom. Well, if Esau, he's still a Shemite, but yeah. Anyway, read on.
The Jewish week had its origin in the creation.
So the week that we consider a week stems from the creation account. Y'all understand? You read it earlier. Genesis 1 is the creation account. Genesis is the beginning. The beginning account of creation. Read again.
The Jewish week had its origin in the creation.
So we learned to have a 7 day week based upon the Lord saying, I made this first day, second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day, sixth day, seventh day I rest, 7 day Yah rest. That's our creation account. That's how a week was born. Go ahead.
And ran consecutively, irrespective of lunar or solar cycles.
He's referring to the Sabbath. He's referring to days of the week. Go ahead.
This was done for man's physical and spiritual welfare.
Go ahead.
The biblical records are silent regarding the observance of the Sabbath day from the creation to the time of Moses. Sabbath observance was either revived or given special emphasis by Moses.
Right. So it says revived. Read that part again?
Sabbath observance was either revived or given special emphasis by Moses.
You know why I'm saying revived? Who knows why I'm saying revived? I didn't observe it before. That's crazy. Why the saying revived? I'm gonna call out. Why the saying revived? It was either revived or given special emphasis by Moses. Why is it saying that? Let's see who knows. I know you know. Y'all raise your hand. Brother knows the answer. Why is his hand? Yeah, you raise your hand first. Go ahead.
It's saying revive because from the beginning it was like that. But what? Then when the Egyptians came to power, it was they was keeping the 10-day Sabbath.
What was in the beginning? What was like what? What was like what? Be more specific.
From the time of Adam, everybody knew that it was the seventh
day. Thank you. Yes. From the beginning, everyone on earth knew the seventh day was the Sabbath day. Then over time, nations scattered abroad, the Tower of Babel, they went their way, did their own thing, started serving their own gods, and they got lost. But then Moses got it back and re-emphasized, listen, from the beginning of time, it says, that's why it says earlier, that the seventh week is of Semitic origin. Because Adam taught to his son, then Seth taught to his son, then Noah taught to his sons, but then Shem in particular, or Israel came out of Shem, we maintained it. Abraham and so forth, they maintained it. You understand? From the beginning, that's why I said it was revived and later on had more emphasis, special emphasis placed upon it. You understand?
Yes, sir.
So it says it was revived, meaning it was brought back because it was being maintained during the creation time. Adam and so they all understood the Sabbath day. Then, of course, it got lost and Moses brought it back. The Most High brought it back through Moses, a Shemite, and reintroduced it to Israel. You understand?
Yes, sir.
So now, let's get Exodus 31. So, did the Lord rest once or twice on the seventh day? Did he rest once or twice? Did he rest once in the evening and he rest again in the daytime? The seventh day? Took a nap and then in the daytime? Anyone? Anyone read across that? Is it in Genesis 2? Genesis 5? Anyone come across that anywhere in the Bible? I haven't come across it yet. I'm still waiting for it. Get Exodus 31, please.
The book of Exodus, chapter 31.
So far we have the Lord resting one time. And until I see a second time, I'm going to deal with what he did the first time. Exodus 31 and verse 16.
Exodus chapter 31, verse 16. Wherefore, the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath.
Uh-huh.
To observe the Sabbath throughout their generations.
Uh-huh.
For a perpetual covenant.
Uh-huh.
It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever.
So the Sabbath, which is heavy, the Sabbath was created long before Israel came into existence. And it was a sign that the Lord was going to have his special people for him forever, before we were even in existence. As Israelites, I'll say that. As Israelites, I'll say that. You understand? The Lord had created the Sabbath day not only to rest upon, but also as a sign of his relationship between him and his only chosen people. All right? So the Sabbath is made for us, our nation, period. Aside from the planet and everybody else on it, the Sabbath is also made for Israel as well. Go ahead.
Excuse me.
Verse 17 again.
It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever.
Uh-huh.
For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed.
So he's letting you know that the Sabbath is based upon the creation account. 6 days he worked, 7 day he rested. Go ahead, and he was refreshed. Go ahead.
And he gave unto Moses, when he had made an end of communing with him upon Mount Sinai, 2 tables of testimony. Tables of stone written with the finger of God.
All right, commandments. So now, look at Wikipedia real quick. Babylonian calendar. Now, the doctrine is that the time when Israel observed the Sabbath from even to even is of Babylonian origin. It came from Babylon. That's where it came from. So apparently, since the Babylonians, day began in the evening and ended in the evening, it's of Babylonian origin. That's the idea being taught now. That's the idea, the doctrine being spread now. Y'all understand what I'm saying so far?
Yes, sir.
I'm going to say it again. The doctrine is that the Israelites learned an evening to evening day, beginning and ending, from Babylon. That's what they're saying. So we're going to see if that's true. Sumerian, third dynasty, that's Babylon. Go down. Go to months. No, matter of fact, start there, be there.
The Babylonian calendar was a lunar solar calendar.
Lunar solar means sun and moon. Moon and sun calendar. Go ahead, they observe both. Go ahead.
With years consisted of 12 lunar months.
Yeah, 12 months in a year as well. Go ahead.
Each beginning when a new crescent moon was first sighted low on the western horizon at
sunset. And they observed a new moon as well, but it was a crescent moon. They observed the moon as well. Go ahead. So I guess we got that from them also. Go ahead.
Plus an intercalary month.
So they also had what we had. We had an intercalary month. They would add an extra month in. So their observances of days would fall in sync. So we got that from them also. Go ahead.
Inserted as needed by decree.
Like us. Go ahead.
The calendar is based on a Sumerian third dynasty of Ur.
Ur, that's where Abraham came from. Go ahead.
Predecessor. preserved in the Uma calendar of Shugai.
Go down. So far they have a 12-month year like us. They had a new moon like us. So I guess we got everything from them. Okay. Go ahead. Read that.
The year begins in spring.
Stop. So I guess we got that from them also. Their year began in the spring like us. Oh, we got that from Babylon too. Interesting, because I know last time I checked, the Babylonian Empire was in existence long before we were even in existence. And the laws of God were given to, well, I'll get to that later. I'm not going to move too fast. Go ahead. The year begins where?
The year begins in spring, mm-hmm. and is divided into Resati, beginning, Misati, middle, and Kisati, end of the year.
Right. Go ahead.
The word for month was Aru.
Right. Go ahead. Go down. Jump down state. To the Assyrian calendar used in Iraq. Go there.
Where's that?
Down to the bottom.
Okay. The Assyrian calendar.
No. Go to during the of the Assyrians is assigned.
Okay, I see that. During
the 6th century, yeah.
Yeah. During the 6th century B.C., Babylonian captivity.
Stop. Stop. Babylonian captivity of the Hebrews. So right here is when we went into captivity under them. You understand?
Right.
This is when we first encountered them right here. They enslaved us during this time, 500s B.C., 6th century. They took us into captivity. Go ahead.
During the 6th century B.C., Babylonian captivity of the Hebrews,
uh-huh.
The Babylonian month names were adopted into the Hebrew calendar.
Because we had our own Hebrew names for our months, but we borrowed theirs. Because our calendars were very, very similar. They had an extra month to their year like us. Their year started in the spring like us, so we borrowed it. Mm. We borrowed the names. That's when you read Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, you'll find Babylonian names for the months, like Nisan, Adar, Kislev, I think that's Greek. Kislev, whatever. We borrowed Babylonian names for our months because our calendars are very, 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 very similar. Very similar. Go ahead. And remember, Babylon's thing was assimilation. So it wasn't hard for us to assimilate with a society that maintained a calendar very much close to our own. So we borrowed the months of their gods and added them to our months, which is wrong. We shouldn't have done that, but we did. Like today, we say, rather than say day one, day two, day three, what do we say? Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Not because we worship the gods, but because that's what we know them today. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Those are all gods. Sunday, Moon Day, Tuesday's a god. Odin's Day is Wednesday. Thor's Day is Thursday. Frigga's or Freya's Day is Friday. Saturn Day is Saturday. Sunday is Sunday. These are all pagan gods. Even the planets of Earth, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, those are gods. You understand? But we don't worship that, but just so we in this captivity, we adopted the names that we were given right. while here. You understand?
Yes, sir.
Who was confused? I hope not. Real quick, regarding confusion, give me Sirach real quick. 20, I can't stand it. And people sit there, say they're not confused and still be confused. Sirach 20 and verse 22, I think it is. This will be the downfall of many in Israel if y'all keep doing it.
The book of Sirach, chapter 20,
Let me see what else I want. 20 and verse 22.
Verse 22. There is that destroyeth his own soul.
There is means there is a person, male or female. There is a person, or there is, go ahead.
That destroyeth his own soul.
That will destroy him or herself from what?
Through bashfulness.
Through bashfulness. What is bashfulness? Define it, please. Definition, I want bashful. There was one that destroys his or her own soul through bashfulness. What does bashfulness mean?
Bashful. Reluctant to draw attention to oneself.
Right. You don't want to be put on the spot. I don't know the answer. I'm just going to sit here quiet and not say anything. I don't know the answer. I'm just going to sit here quiet. Click the translations. I want synonyms. Shy, reserved, diffident, inhibited, retiring, reticent. What is that word? Reticent. Right.
Reluctant.
Shrinking, hesitant, timid, apprehensive, nervous, wary, demure, coy. Click apprehensive, please. Antonyms is bold and confident. That's the opposite, bold and confident. Click apprehensive. Same word.
Apprehensive.
Go ahead, read it. Go ahead.
Anxious or fearful that something bad or unpleasant will happen.
Right, synonyms.
Anxious, worried, uneasy, nervous, concerned, agitated, tense, afraid, scared, frightened, fearful.
That right there. Those words go hand in hand with being bashful. Afraid. You had the humble form of bashfulness as in like shamefaced. It's the same word. Shamefaced, respectful. And you have that cowardly spirit where I don't want to be embarrassed. I don't know the answer, but I don't want to look stupid. So I'll just sit here and be quiet and not say anything and be dumb and not know nothing. You can't be like that. You cannot be like that in Israel. You must, if you're confused, say you're confused. Go back to the verse again.
There is that destroyeth his own soul through bashfulness.
Through bashfulness, fear, nervousness, weariness. Go ahead.
And by accepting of persons, overthroweth himself.
Meaning what? Meaning you're afraid of men who are over you to ask questions. You're afraid a peer will embarrass you or something like that. If you're nervous or don't know the answer, so out of respect for us, you'll destroy yourself because you don't want to know the you have questions and refuse to ask them. Or you're confused. And many brothers and sisters in here will leave for that very reason. They'll be fearful and scared to approach men over them. And rather than be confident and bold, the antonym, they'll do the opposite and be scared and nervous and just sit around and not say anything. I'm going to say to myself, I'm not going to say anything, be quiet. Then harbor a certain level of hatred for us and bitterness over time for having a problem with us or whatever. I could take this somewhere else easy. But I'm showing you that when you have that bashful, fearful spirit, it says that you will destroy yourself. That's why I asked multiple times, do you understand? And so far, I've heard multiple times, yes. So I'm going to assume that you understand. Or you'll be lost and end up in, somewhere confused.
Hey, listen, we ain't got a problem with you all, like, asking us questions and so forth, but just don't be disrespectful with it, you know? That's the only thing. Just don't be disrespectful. There's nothing for you all to talk to the men over you and so forth, mm-hmm. But if you come in a disrespectful manner, you know, that's something else. That's when you're going to be checked, you understand? Right. But, yeah, man.
Go back to Wikipedia again. So your year begins, go ahead. Now go to the Assyrian calendar used.
The Assyrian calendar used in Iraq.
That's what Babylon is. Go ahead.
And the Levant also used many of the same names for its months, such as Iyar, Tammuz, Ab, Elul, Tereshi, and Adar.
You'll find those words in the Bible. You'll find Tammuz there. You'll find Elul, I believe. You'll find Adar, definitely. I think Elul's in there. Not Ab. That's not there. Go down. So the Babylonians had this long before us. But go down. The year begins in spring. Go down. I don't want that. It just came from there. Until the 5th century. Do I want that? No. Go to days. Go to days. Right there.
Days.
Uh-huh.
Counting from the new moon.
So counting from their new moon. They had their own new moon observations they had. Go ahead.
The Babylonians celebrated every seventh day as a holy day.
So count from the new moon that they observed. You have Israelites that do this also. That's from Babylon, where they would count the new moon, and then from 7 days after that moon, they would count a week. So you have, for example, after the moon, you'll have day seven. 7 days later, day 14. 7 days later, you'll have day 21. Then you have day 28. Right, so that's how they kept their observances of the holy days. You understand? So they were from the moon is day seven, then day 14, then day 21, counting by sevens, then 28. You understand? Or eight, then 15, then 22, and then 29. You understand? Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Also called an evil day, meaning unsuitable for prohibited activity.
They had a Sabbath. The Babylonians had a Sabbath. They had one also. This is an ancient civilization that maintained these things. Their year started in the spring. They had a 7-day Sabbath as well, but theirs was counted different from ours. Go ahead.
On these days, officials were prohibited from various activities and common men were forbidden to make a wish.
So they made wishes. That's your birthday right there. Go ahead.
And at least the 28th was known as a rest day.
That was the last. That was so the last of their week. It was also considered their Sabbath day as well, the 28th day. The 20th, because remember I said earlier, the 7th, the 14th, 21st, 28th. You understand?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So
can I say something?
Yeah.
But where you all think they got all of this from?
I'm just going to go there.
Oh, you got
it. Yeah, I'm going to go there. I'm going to show you where they got it from. Because remember, their year started in the spring. They had a 12-month cycle and so forth. 7-day week. Let's go to 1 Peter 2. Show you where it came from. I'm going to go before Babylon. 2 Peter 2:5. Sorry about that. 2 Peter 2:5.
2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5. And spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness.
But saved Noah. Remember, it says the old world. He didn't spare the old world. He destroyed it by water, by drowning it. He did not spare the old world, but saved someone out of it, which would be Noah, the eighth person. Go ahead. A preacher of what?
A preacher of righteousness.
A preacher of righteousness. A preacher of righteousness. Go ahead.
Bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly.
Upon the old world of the ungodly. The ungodly of the old world. So Noah was a preacher of righteousness. What was he preaching that was righteous? Go to the next chapter. Chapter 3 and verse 5.
Second Peter chapter 3 verse 4. And saying, where is the promise of his coming?
Because you always had scorners and scoffers even back then. Go ahead.
For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation.
Go ahead.
For this they are willingly ignorant of, that by the word of God.
That by that, what?
By the word of God.
That by the word of God. That by the word of God. Go ahead.
The heavens of old.
The heavens of old. What old? The old world. That was not spared in the chapter prior. You remember that? 2 and 5? The old world? Go ahead. Word of God, the heavens of old, go ahead.
And the earth standing out of the water and in the water.
The old world that stood outside the water ended up in the water. Go ahead.
Whereby the world that then was.
The old world that then was, that Noah was spared from, go ahead.
Being overflowed with water.
Out of water, not in the water. Go ahead.
Perished.
Got destroyed. Next verse.
But the heavens and the earth, which are now.
The world that is now. The current world that's now. Go ahead.
By the same word.
By the same word being preached back then to the ungodly back then in the old world. Go ahead.
Are kept in store, reserved unto fire. Against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men.
So what was Noah preaching to the old world in the time, in the beginning, in the old world? What was he preaching? Don't call out. Do not. I hate that. Don't call out. Who knows who he was preaching? It said it in the verse. Yes.
Shalom.
Shalom.
Christ bless. He was teaching the same laws we teach now.
Thank you. Where's that? What verse is that?
Yeah, verse 7, but the heavens and the earth, which are now by the same word, are kept in store.
Thank you. By the same word of God being preached back to by Noah, a preacher of righteousness back then, the preacher of righteousness back then was preaching the word of God to the ungodly back then. They didn't listen. They didn't listen then, and a lot of them ain't gonna listen now. Right. They got drowned back then, they're gonna burn now. Same spirits coming back over and over again, recycled over and over again. You understand? So Noah was preaching righteousness back then. That's how his family was spared. Noah was righteous. His wife was righteous. His sons are righteous. And their wives were taught as well by the husbands. So they were all spared, all eight of them. You understand? So Noah taught his sons righteousness. So they maintained Noah's righteousness when they got off the ship. Then over time, it said earlier in the dictionary, it got revived because over time it got lost. Only Shem's line eventually maintained it. Out of Abraham, the righteous seed out of Shem's line maintained it. Ham and Japheth went their own little way, went their own way. Genesis 9. Just to back it up. Genesis 9,
Genesis chapter 9, verse 26. And he said, blessed be the Lord God of Shem.
Read again.
And he said, blessed be the Lord God of Shem, and Canaan shall be his servant.
Why did he say blessed be the Lord God of Shem? Because God will only deal with a special lineage coming out of Shem, which would be who? The Israelites. Why? Because he already made that clear during the creation, when he made the Sabbath. Now the sign between him and Israel before there was even an Israel. Y'all understand? Who does not understand? Don't be bashful. Shamefaced. All right. Going once, going twice. Okay. A And he said, blessed be the Lord God of Shem. Blessed be the Lord God of Shem. Because the Lord was going to deal with the special seed he chose out of Shem, who would revive the same things that were taught during the time of Adam, during the creation. 7-day Sabbath, the year beginning in the spring, 12-month year. Some of the heathens maintained it, some did not. We did not learn that from them. We had it already. It was already around before that, but long before them. Go back to Wikipedia again. So they had a 12-month calendar, sometimes 13. Like, for example, this year, this so-called year, 2018, we had exactly, if you count 12 months, we had 13 moons. That's why our feast days fell so late. I taught this at Tabernacles. Yeah. Thank you, Jonah, for falling asleep and not putting the video up. Anyway, we had 13 months. 13 months. 13 moons this year. 13 moons this year. All right, so all our feast days fell at a later date because usually Passover falls between late March, early April. We had it late April because things are moved, things are shifted to a later time. We had an extra month. You can look and see for yourself. Go back to January and count each moon. Count each full moon. You're going to find 13 of 2000, so-called 2018, 12 months, whatever. That's why even if you count from the time of March, April, it will still be, everything still falls late. So they had to add an extra month, intercalary month, or inserted month to keep all the feast days to fall in their proper season, or things will be out of whack. You'll be keeping Passover in the wintertime, which is madness. So they had to add an extra month to keep all the feast days in their proper seasons. The Babylonians did the same exact thing because they learned it from Noah and them, how to maintain days and so forth. It was all kept back then. Not feast days, but in terms of the Sabbath and so forth, but how to maintain the calendar properly. From the creation account, they did these things. You understand?
Yes, sir.
Who doesn't get it? Because you had 13 moons this year. 13 moons. So they had to add an extra month so the feast days fall in their proper season. The feast days fall in their proper season. Like, for example, this year, when was Passover? April what? Yeah, what do you know? It was later April. It wasn't early March. It wasn't late March, early April. It fell at a later time. So Israel would add an extra month in so that each feast day would fall in their proper time. If they did not do that, you'll have Passover in the fall. Then you'll have Tabernacles in the winter. And you'll have Hanukkah. And you understand what I'm saying? They had to add these things. It's called a leap year. Esau calls it a leap year. Every 4 years, every 2 or 3 years, we had an extra month. And we would do that. It's called Vidar, or second Adar. You remember Adar? Yeah. We called it Vidar, or second Adar. We would add an extra month so that our feast days would fall in their proper season. I'm going to get to that. I'll explain. It'll come to you later on, or be in that video if it ever comes out, this ever. Tabernacles. I went over that already. Let's go to what I sent you, the notes I have. I try to write neat as possible. I didn't feel like writing up no pen. So I wrote it. It's my notes. You're going to see my shadow over the camera. It's going to be crazy. But just deal with it tonight. Because bootleg tonight. I'm on the mood tonight. I sent it to you. It's in the group, I think. Yeah. Now, let's blow it up. So it only goes to the Saturday, Sunday. Just blow it up some. Yeah, it's a notebook. Ignore that. But we went over that already. Bring it up to where it says example. Move it up some right there. Yep, right there. So I gave an example. The slash represents even to even. All right? The slash in between the Saturday, Sunday. So now, I'm only making it 12 hours, 6 p.m. and 6 a.m. just to keep it simple. Because sometimes you have longer days than nights, or not longer nights than days. But on occasion, it's even. When you have what is called the spring, you have what is called the spring or fall equinox.
Right.
That is when you have equal hours of both day and night. 12 hours of day, 12 hours of night. You understand? It's called equinoxes. Equinox equal means it's equinox equal as an equal, nox as in night. Because the night hours match the day hours. You understand? Because there's always 12 hours in the day.
Right.
So night matches up with the day. So it's equal night, equinox. You understand? Yes, that happens during the time of the fall. That happens during the time of the spring. Then the winter time comes, you have longer days than summer, shorter nights. Winter, you have what? Longer nights, shorter days, called right. solstices. It's called a solstice. Winter solstice, summer solstice. You understand? Mm-hmm. Go to what I sent you. So now, I'm going to start. You have Saturday, Sunday. I'm going to clear it up. Saturday. Let's start from what we both know. Saturday, Sunday, right? Saturday, sundown is the Sunday sundown is day one. Sunday sundown, Monday sundown is day two. Monday sundown to Tuesday sundown is day three. Tuesday to Wednesday is day four. Wednesday to Thursday is day five. Thursday to Friday is day six. Friday to Saturday is day seven. Now, I'm going to start from day seven because some of y'all are confused already. I just read them from Sweden. Friday, Saturday is the seventh day, right? Friday evening to Saturday is the seventh day, right?
Right.
Friday evening to Saturday is day seven. So Friday evening marks the beginning of day seven, right? So Saturday evening marks what? Day what?
Day one.
Day one. So Saturday sundown to Sunday sundown is day what?
One.
One. So from Friday, Saturday, it's day seven. Then when the sun goes down on Saturday, when we're all in here, like right now, this is day one.
Right.
It's day one.
Right.
It's not day seven anymore. Now, so let's say, for example, it gets dark at 6 p.m., right? It gets black. It's black outside. I'm going to say black outside. Make it clear as I can. Black outside at 6 p.m., black stars, dark, no sun. Not blue, not navy blue, black stars. Blacker than Wesley, you understand?
Okay. Yes.
6 p.m., dark, right? So at 5:45, what day is it?
What day is that?
At 5:45. 7 day, 5:45? Oh, I said day seven. What time of the year? What the hell? I'm talking about now. Let's just say, let me go backwards. Jones confusing me and upset me at the same time. let's say right now, right? It does get dark around 6 o'clock. Well, 5 now. It's getting dark because winter's coming. So we're having longer nights. But I'm going to go back to the fall because the fall is balanced. Autumn equinox, fall equinox. When, let's say at 6 p.m. on Saturday, what day is that? When it's pure black outside. That's the first day. 5:45, what day is that? Seventh day. So even means when it's blackout. Remember darkness this evening?
Yeah.
So the seventh day at even when it's black, what day is it? Day one. Thank you. That's it. Y'all understand?
Yes, sir.
Who does not understand? Don't be bashful. You understand now? Hope they understand now. I'll explain it again. There's the only few minutes difference between the seventh day of the week and the first day of the week. It's minutes difference. Minutes difference. Not hours, minutes difference between the seventh day at even, then going into the first day at even. The seventh day, when it's black outside, is the first day of the week. Yes. Mike.
That explains Matthew 28, verse 1.
Yes, it does. He caught on. That explains Matthew 28 and 1. That explains it. I'm not going to go over that, but I'm done with that. That's a dead horse. I'm just helping you understand time so you can figure it out yourself. Friday, Saturday. So Friday evening, sundown, blackout, is what? The seventh day. Right? Then when Saturday, black outside, evening, what day is that? It's day one. So the seventh day at evening is day one. The sixth day at evening is the fifth day at evening is the fourth day at evening is that's what I'm showing you on the screen. Saturday, Sunday, sundown, it's day one. Sunday, Monday, sundown, it's day two. Monday, sundown, Tuesday, sundown, day three. Tuesday to Wednesday, day four. Wednesday to Thursday, day five. Thursday to Friday, day six. Day six at evening is what? The seventh day. So when it goes, when it's dark outside on Friday, that's the end of the sixth day, starting what? The seventh. The Sabbath. Y'all got it now? I think that's the most easy I can make it. If you don't got that, I just pray for you and hope you don't have any children. Let's go. Let's go. I'm just joking. Oh, man. Sort of. Go to Vernal Equinox. Vernal Equinox, I sent you the link. I think it's DaytonTown.com. I think I sent you that one. It explains in brief what I just explained. So in the fall and in the spring, you have Esau. It's called spring equinox. As they say, it's equal 12 hours of day, equal 12 hours of night. Esau, of course, likes to be confusing. Go, oh, it's not, technically, it's not completely or 12 hours equal. You have eight, it's like, it's about 5 to 6 minutes of more daytime than night, whatever. Whatever, semantics. But there are 24 hours in a day. Esau goes, no, that's not true. There's 23 hours sometimes. 23 hours, 56 minutes and 4 seconds. Whatever, 24 hours. I don't have time for that. It's confusing me. 12 hours each. That's why Christ said, are there not 12 hours in the day?
Right.
John 11. Mm-hmm. Talking about himself as well as time itself. Listen, I'm up on y'all coming along. Are there not 12 hours in the day? And that was around Passover time when he said that. And that's spring equinox time, when it's 12 hours of day and 12 hours of night, around that same season. And you read the following chapter, or later on the chapter. I want it. Go to the other one. That explains, well, hold that. Go to equinox. It says equinox, equal day and night. Almost, because it's about a 6 minutes more day than night, whatever. Esau and his semantics. Why is it called equinox then if it's not equal? Equinox is equal. Whatever. Go to the next one. Go to equinox definition. Equinox definition. Type that in. Equinox definition. Just because the heathens and Israelites had similar customs doesn't mean we got it from them. These things are known since the beginning of time. You understand? You even have pictures of heathens with fringes on, except the ribbon of blue. They didn't have that. Romans had them. Assyrians had them. Doesn't mean that we got it from them. You understand? Stupidity. Equinox. See, equal, then nox, go down, it says night. Listen to y'all know. Go down more some. See, nox, not, night, like nocturnal.
Right.
Nocturnal night. Equal nights, the night at, and it says usually around the time of September 22nd to March 30th, 20th, fall to spring equinox. The hours are all equal. They're all in sync. 12 hours a day, 12 hours a night. It's a balanced day. Until summer and winter when it's longer days and shorter night and then shorter days in winter. Go to solstice. Wikipedia solstice. It might be in there. I don't know. This is help y'all out. Solstice Wikipedia. The information in Wikipedia is common, so that's why I'm using Wikipedia just for now. I can use other, if you want to go somewhere else, look it up on your own, you're more than welcome. This is just the easiest I want to find. The solstice is an event occurring when the sun appears, blah, blah, blah. Go out on science stuff. I don't understand that. The term solstice can be used, broader sense, in the day when this day occurs, the day of the hemisphere. See, the day of a solstice is in either, start from there, Osiris. The day of a solstice.
The day of a solstice in either hemisphere.
Meaning southern or northern, go ahead.
Has either the most sunlight of the year, or the least.
Hold on, read that part too. Oh, summer.
Summer solstice.
Right, that's the longer days. Go ahead.
Or the least sunlight of the year.
Right.
Winter solstice.
Winter solstice. Go ahead.
For any place other than the equator.
Right. So it's also referred to as the June solstice or December solstice. Summer or winter solstice. You understand? In both hemispheres. Oh, we're in now and the one under us. You understand? Who doesn't understand? Okay. Y'all understand how to count the days now? You understand that the seventh day at evening is the first day of the week?
Right.
And the sixth day at evening is?
Seven.
And the fifth day at evening is? Six. And the fourth day at evening is? And the third? Four. And the second? Third. And the first? Third. There you go. Whew. Y'all are exhausting. Exodus 12 and 1. Exodus 12 and 1. It's hard for me also. Like I said before, I say over time, and I teach y'all, I teach myself. Because the solstice stuff, I don't know about this stuff. This is new to me. Solstice and equinox. I'm like, what the hell is this? I was looking it up. I said, okay, this is good to know. It's something good to know. So I'm teaching myself as well. So don't feel embarrassed if you don't understand. Because I didn't understand when I first started looking over it myself. So don't feel embarrassed now. Exodus 12 and 1.
The book of Exodus, chapter 12, verse 1. And the Lord spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months.
Because when he was in Egypt, their calendar was different from ours. Unlike Babylon, Egypt's calendar was different from ours. The Lord said, from now on, this shall be the beginning of your months. This right here marks the beginning of your months, means the full moon was bloom. He said, okay, the moon right there. This marks the first of your month. Your first month right here. Y'all understand? You understand so far? Go ahead, read again. Verse 2.
This month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you.
So the first thing the Lord gave us in Egypt, he gave us the beginning of our month. Our first month, which will be what it's called? First month is called a... Not the month. That's the year. The month. What's it called? This is called right here.
A new year.
So first month is called new...
New year.
The new moon. New moon, new moon, new moon, the first moon. Every moon is a new moon, every new moon. He gave us that first. Yes, sir, babe, yes. Yes, that's the first, that's the, right. That's a season, yes. But this is the first month in the month of a bib, yes. It is a bib, yes, you're right. But it's the first month. You understand? New moon. So he gave us, the first thing he gave us was a new moon. You understand? Y'all understand? So he's giving us a new moon here first, right?
Right.
Y'all clear?
Right.
All right. That was verse 2, right?
Yes, sir.
Go to Psalms 81 real quick.
The book of Psalms, chapter 81. Verse 3?
Yes, thank you.
Verse 3. Blow up the trumpet in the new moon. In the time appointed on our solemn feast day.
Read again.
Blow up the trumpet in the new moon.
Uh-huh.
In the time appointed on our solemn feast day.
Now, in this verse, Esau being slick as he is, other translations, it says full moon. And it's the time appointed right there, it says full moon. All right? But regardless, the new moon's a full moon. We've been over this, so we beat this horse also. That's old news. But the full moon's the new moon. Read on our solemn feast day. Read the next verse.
For this was a statute for Israel and a law of the God of Jacob.
Go ahead.
This he ordained in Joseph for a testimony.
Why does he mention Joseph? Because Joseph placed us in Egypt.
This he ordained in Joseph for a testimony when he went out through the land of Egypt, where I heard a language that I understood not. I removed his shoulder from the burden. His hands were delivered from the pots.
Read verse 5 again.
Verse 5. This he ordained in Joseph for a testimony, when he went out through the land of Egypt, where I heard a language that I understood not.
The door. Hold on. Check the door. Read again. Verse 5 again. I'm sorry. Read verse 5 again.
This he ordained in Joseph for a testimony, when he went out through the land of Egypt, where I heard a language that I understood not.
So he ordained this in Egypt. So he ordained this day in Egypt. The new moon was ordained in Egypt. He said, this shall be the beginning of your months, referring to the month what? A month of Bib.
Right.
The first month. So he gave us the new moon first, right? And it was established when we was in Egypt. This month is your first month. You understand? So we observe that every month, the new moon, right? You understand so far?
Right.
So when we was in Egypt, he said, this is your new moon. It's your first month. It's called the Bib. It's the first month right here. That's a new moon right there.
Yeah.
Now, let's go to Exodus 12 and 3. Let's go back.
Exodus chapter 12, verse 3. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month, they shall take to them every man a lamb according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. And if And if the household be too little for the lamb,
I'm sorry. Be verse 3 one more time. Verse 3. Emphasizing that. Yeah.
Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month.
The 10th day of the month of Bib. Go ahead.
They shall take to them every man a lamb according to the house of their fathers. A lamb for an house.
Go ahead. Keep going.
And if the house be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man according to his eating shall make your count for the lamb.
Go ahead, verse 5.
Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it out from the sheep or from the goats.
So we allow the sacrifice of Passover either a sheep or a goat. Go ahead.
And you shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month.
So the 10th month, you grab your best of your sheep or your goat. You hold it down from the 10th day to the 14th day. Remember, it says the 10th day you pick. I got it. I found it. The 10th day you pick the goat or the sheep you have and the best of your best. And then the 14th day. Go ahead. 4 days later. Go ahead.
And the 14th day of the same month. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it in the evening.
On the 14th day. You understand? So the 10th day you hold on to it, your best of your flock, hold it separate from all the rest. And the 14th day you kill it, either your sheep or your best of your sheep or your goat for the Passover. All right? Read on.
In the evening. And they shall take of the blood and strike it on the two side posts and the upper door of the upper doorpost of the houses wherein they shall eat it.
So this is all to be done on the 14th day. This is all to be done on the 14th day. Y'all follow? Go ahead.
And they shall eat the flesh in that night.
In that night. That evening. You shall eat the flesh of it that evening. 14th day. Go ahead.
Roast with fire and unleavened bread. And with bitter herbs they shall eat it.
That's what we do. Go ahead.
Eat not of it raw nor sodden at all with water.
Don't boil it.
But roast it with fire, his head with his legs, and with the pertinence thereof.
The whole body, go ahead.
And ye shall let nothing of it remain until the morning, and that which remaineth of it until the morning ye shall burn with fire.
Uh-huh.
And thus ye shall eat it, with your loins girded,
fully dressed,
and your shoes upon your feet, and your staff in your hand, and ye shall eat it in haste.
Eat it fast, go ahead.
It is the Lord's Passover.
That's all you want. It is the Lord's Passover. Read on. So remember, it says, eat it that night and eat it fast while fully dressed. Go ahead.
For I will pass through the land of Egypt this night.
When?
This night.
This night. The 14th day at evening, this night. Go ahead.
And will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast. And against all the gods of Egypt will I execute judgment. I am the Lord.
Go ahead.
And the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where ye are.
Right.
And when I see the blood, I will pass over you.
That's the term Passover. Go ahead.
And the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt.
When I kill the firstborn. Go ahead.
And this day shall be unto you for
this day, 14th day, shall be unto you for a memorial. Go ahead.
For a memorial. And ye shall keep it a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. And ye shall keep it a feast by an ordinance forever.
Go ahead.
7 days shall ye eat unleavened bread.
Mm-hmm.
Even the first day ye shall put away leaven out of your houses.
Yeah.
For whosoever eateth leavened bread from the first day until the seventh day, that soul shall be cut off from Israel.
Yeah.
And in the first day there shall be an holy convocation, and in the seventh day there shall be an holy convocation to you. No manner of work shall be done in them, save that which every man must eat. That only may be done of you.
So the first day and 7 days is a what? Is a Sabbath. Is a Sabbath. Notice this takes place that evening. The first day and the seventh day.
Right. When it says the 14th day at evening, right?
Yeah, don't.
Okay, you got it?
Yeah. I want them to figure it out on their own. Yeah, John, so the first day and seventh day are what? The first day and seventh day are what? The first day and seventh day? Sabbaths. John 19:31. We're going to fast forward into time real quick when the Messiah, during the time of Passover, in his time. We're going to see what the first day was called.
Hey, all of you brothers should learn to count the days for the high holy days and so forth, man. You know, every last one of y'all got to learn this. Y'all never know what could happen and we could be separated and scattered throughout the four corners of the earth. You never know what could happen. Y'all learn to check. So y'all pay attention, man. Learn to check the high holy days.
John 19, verse 31.
The book of John, chapter 19, verse 31. The Jews, therefore, because it was the preparation that the bodies should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day.
Bodies should not remain on the cross on the Sabbath. On the what?
On the Sabbath day.
Go ahead.
For that Sabbath.
For that what?
For that Sabbath day was in high day.
For that Sabbath day when he was on that cross was in high day. What day was that? Passover. That's why it's a high day. The first day of Passover was a high day, a Sabbath. Go ahead.
Besought Pilate that their legs might be broken, and that they might be taken away.
Right. So you want to focus on the fact that that day, that Sabbath evening, that the first day of Passover was a high day. It was a Sabbath. So the first day amongst Israel has always been at the evening, the first the evening. The first day is the evening. Sabbath. You understand? All right. Exodus 12 now, verse 17.
Exodus chapter 12, verse 17.
So now, again, what we have is the first day is a Sabbath, and the seventh day is a Sabbath at evening. Go ahead.
And ye shall observe the feast of unleavened bread, for in this selfsame day have I brought your armies out of the land of Egypt. Therefore shall ye observe this day in your generations by an ordinance forever.
Watch this, verse 18.
In the first month, on the 14th day of the month at even.
When?
At even.
When?
At even.
On the day.
At even.
At evening. This night. Remember that? Mm-hmm. This night. Go ahead.
Ye shall eat unleavened bread until the 1 and 20th day of the month at even.
Right. 7 days. Go ahead. 21 days. 14th day to the 21st day. 7 days. Go ahead.
7 days shall there be no leaven found in your houses. For whosoever eateth that which is leaven, even that soul shall be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether he be a stranger or born in the land.
Go ahead.
Ye shall eat nothing leaven in all your habitations. Ye shall eat unleavened bread.
Wherever you are and throughout the world, you have to have nothing leavened, only unleavened bread for those 7 days. Go ahead. Because Israel got scattered eventually. Go ahead. So he said, wherever your habitation will be in the future from now, no leaven. Unleavened bread for 7 days. Go ahead.
Then Moses called for all the elders of Israel and said unto them, draw out and take you a lamb.
That you had in the 10th day, that you took out on the 10th day, go ahead.
Draw out and take you a lamb according to your families and kill the Passover.
The 14th day, go ahead, at evening, go ahead.
And ye shall take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin and strike the lintel and the two side posts with the blood that is in the basin. And none of you shall go out at the door of his house until the morning.
Go ahead.
For the Lord will pass through to smite the Egyptians. And when he seeth the blood upon the lintel and on the two side posts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not suffer the destroyer to come into your houses to smite you.
That's Christ there. Go ahead. 24.
And you shall observe this thing for an ordinance to thee and to thy sons forever.
Go ahead.
And it shall come to pass when ye come to the land which the Lord will give you according as he hath promised that ye shall keep this service. And it shall come to pass when your children shall say unto you, what mean ye by this service?
Why are we doing this? Go ahead.
That ye shall say, it is the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, who passed over the houses of the children of Israel in Egypt when he smote the Egyptians and delivered our houses. And the people bowed the head and worshiped.
Go ahead.
And the children of Israel went away and did as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron, so did they.
Go ahead.
And it came to pass that at midnight.
At when?
At midnight.
At when?
At midnight.
Midnight. Midnight. It's still dark. Midnight. Go ahead.
The Lord smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne unto the firstborn of the captive that was in the dungeon. and all the firstborn of cattle.
He killed the firstborn of the king and of the Pharaoh and the firstborn of all the convicts. They all, everyone lost their firstborn. Everyone and everything, cattle was included, lost their firstborn that night. Go ahead. It was much death that night. Go ahead.
And Pharaoh rose up in the night. He and all his servants and all the Egyptians.
Pharaoh rose up when?
In the night.
In the night. Same time. Go ahead.
He and all his servants and all the Egyptians. And there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where there was not one dead.
There was dead people everywhere. Everywhere. Go ahead.
And he called for Moses and Aaron by night.
By when?
By night.
When?
By night.
So keep in mind that there were many dead. There was not one dead. Go ahead.
And said, rise up and get you forth from among my people, both ye and the children of Israel, and go serve the Lord as ye have said.
Get out of here. Leave. Go. Go ahead.
Also take your flocks and your herds as ye have said, and be gone. And bless me also.
Uh-huh.
And the Egyptians were urgent upon the people.
So they rushed us out at night. Go ahead.
That they might send them out of the land in haste.
Fast. Go ahead.
For they said, we all be dead men.
If we don't get these guys out of here, we're all going to die. Get these Israelites out of here. Fast. That's why the Lord, that's why Moses told Israel, when you eat the leavened bread, eat the lamb, have your clothes on, your staff in your hand, your shoes in your feet. You're going to be rushed out of there. They're going to kick y'all out of there. You're going to get a nationwide eviction. Out. Get out. No rent. You good. Out. Get out of here. Go ahead.
And the people took their dough before it was leavened, their kneading troughs, being bound up in their clothes upon their shoulders.
Took their stuff. They took their things with them. Go ahead.
And the children of Israel did according to the word of Moses. And they borrowed of the Egyptians jewels of silver and jewels of gold.
The Egyptians gave us all their wealth. Here, take some gold. Here, go. Here, take some chains. Here, some diamonds. Go. Go ahead.
And raiment.
And clothing too. Go ahead.
And the Lord gave the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, so that they lent unto them such things as they required. And they spoiled the Egyptians.
Took all their stuff. Go ahead.
And the children of Israel sojourned from Ramses to Succoth.
We sojourned from Ramses to Succoth. Keep that in mind. We sojourned from Ramses to Succoth. That was the journey. So Ramses to Succoth. Go ahead.
About 600,000 on foot that were men besides children.
Go ahead.
And a mixed multitude went up also with them, and flocks and herds, and even very much cattle.
Go ahead.
And they baked unleavened cakes of the dough which they brought forth out of Egypt. For it was not leavened, because they were thrust out of Egypt and could not tarry. Uh-huh. Neither had they prepared for themselves any victual.
Any food. Go ahead.
Now, the sojourning of the children of Israel who dwelt in Egypt was...
No, sorry. I saw one. 39. 39 again.
And they baked unleavened cakes of the dough which they brought forth out of Egypt. For it was not leavened, because they were thrust out of Egypt and could not tarry.
Not stay. Go ahead.
Neither had they prepared for themselves any victuals.
So now, let's get... Read on. Read down to 42.
Now the sojourning of the children of Israel who dwelt in Egypt was 430 years.
Go ahead.
And it came to pass at the end of the 430 years, even the selfsame day, it came to pass that all the host of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt.
Go ahead.
And, I mean, it is a night to be much observed.
It is a what?
It is a night to be much observed.
It is a night to be much observed. Go ahead.
Unto the Lord for bringing them out of the land of Egypt.
Go ahead.
This is that night.
This is what?
This is that night.
This is that night. Go ahead.
Of the Lord to be observed of all the children of Israel in their generation.
So this is that night. Let's get Deuteronomy 16, verse 1. Deuteronomy 16, verse 1. Night. Not seeing day here yet. 16, verse 1.
Deuteronomy chapter 16, verse 1. Observe the month of Abib, and keep the Passover unto the Lord thy God. For in the month of Abib, the Lord thy God brought thee forth out of Egypt by night.
Right, so that was our month. The name of the month was called Abib. All right, the first month was be our new moon, and the month was called Abib. You got it, you follow? It means ear of corn, Abib. Go ahead.
Thou shalt therefore sacrifice the Passover unto the Lord thy God of the flock of and the herd in the place which the Lord shall choose to place his name there. thou shalt eat no leavened bread with it. 7 days shalt thou eat unleavened bread therewith, even the bread of affliction. For thou camest forth out of the land of Egypt in haste, and thou mayest remember the day when thou camest forth out of the land of Egypt all the days of thy life. And there shall be no leavened bread seen with thee in all thy coasts 7 days. Neither shall there be anything of flesh which thou sacrificest the first day at even.
When?
At even.
When?
At even.
A day?
At even.
Mistranslation, day? Is that what
at,
it says?
At even.
Oh, okay. Let's make sure. Even. Go ahead.
Remaining all night until the morning.
So now, let's get Numbers 33. First day at even, right? First day at even. Remain all night until the morning. Let's get Numbers 33. Numbers 33 and verse 1. So, what day, don't call out, what day did Israel leave out of Egypt? What day? What number? Who remembers? Don't call out. What number day did Israel, yes.
Shalom, Brother Jordan. 14th day at night.
14th day at night. Very good. I like how you put it that way. 14th day at even, right? Y'all follow? 14th day at night. Sabbath day. Y'all follow? Okay. Numbers 33, verse 1. Numbers 33 and verse, no. Numbers 33 and verse, yeah, verse 1.
The book of Numbers, chapter 33, verse 1. These are the journeys of the children of Israel, which went forth out of the land of Egypt with their armies under the hand of Moses and Aaron.
Uh-huh.
And Moses wrote their goings out according to their journeys by the commandment of the Lord.
So Moses wrote down Israel's sojourning and their journeys. So we wandering from one place to the next. He mentioned earlier from Ramses to Succoth. Remember that? Ramses to Succoth?
Yeah.
So Moses wrote down our travelings, basically. Go ahead. Where we stayed, where we traveled. Go ahead.
And these are their journeys according to their goings out.
So he's explaining our outgoings. Go ahead.
And they departed from Ramses in the first month.
We departed from Ramses in the first month. We departed from Ramses in the first month. The month was called what? Abib. Get me Genesis 46. They departed from Ramses in the first month. Genesis 46 and verse 34.
The book of Genesis, chapter 46, verse 34.
Uh-huh.
That ye shall say, thy servant's trade hath been about cattle from our youth.
And this is Joseph giving us instructions of what to tell Pharaoh to allow us to stay in this plot of land in the land of Egypt. Read again.
That ye shall say, thy servant's trade hath been about cattle from our youth even until now, both we and also our fathers, that she may dwell in the land of Goshen. For every shepherd is an abomination unto the Egyptians.
So the Egyptians hated shepherds. So Joseph, listen, if you want to live separate from the Egyptians, tell them that you're shepherds, and they'll give you land, a land called Goshen. So he gave us a land called Goshen, you understand, in Egypt. What's Goshen called? Let's go to Genesis 47, verse 11.
Genesis.
Next chapter over.
Chapter 47, verse 11.
Uh-huh.
And Joseph placed his father and his brethren and gave them a possession in the land of Egypt, in the best of the land, in the land of Ramses, as Pharaoh had commanded.
So what's Goshen called? Ramses. You understand? Go back to Numbers 33 again.
Numbers chapter 33, verse 3.
Now remember the answer he gave. Brother gave the answer. Jordan said that the 14th at even, he said. Remember that? Y'all remember his answer?
Right.
Okay. Numbers 33.
Verse 3.
Verse 3. Read that again.
And they departed from Ramses in the first month, on the 15th day of the first month.
Stop. What day did we leave again, Jordan? Oh. So why did it say 15th day here? What happened? Is that a mistranslation? I'm confused. Can you help me out? Let's see if you can help me out. Not you, Joy. I know you got it. I just want to see who else got it. I'm trying to call on some bachelor brothers. His hands ain't going up. I'm calling on spiritual hands. Yes, stand up. We departed the 15th day. I thought it was the 14th.
Because at Brother Adahaya,
uh-huh,
as at night, it's a 15 day.
Thank you.
Right.
That's it. So the 14th day at evening is what? 15th day.
Right.
15th day. The 14th day at evening is the 15th day. Stop. The 14th day at evening is the 15th day. Y'all got it now?
Yes, sir.
Because the 6th day at evening is what?
The 7th day.
The 7th day at evening is?
The first
day at evening is?
The second day.
Second day at evening is?
The third day.
Third day at evening is?
Fourth day.
Y'all got it. That's it. It's that simple. 14th day at evening is the 15th day. Read verse 3 again, please.
And they departed from Ramses.
So it's not two separate days. It's one day. And that's why it's very important that we don't be being bashful in here and that our word understanding must be steadfast so we don't fall for nonsensical garbage doctrines. You understand? 3 again.
And they departed from Ramses in the first month. On the 15th day of the first month, on the morrow after the Passover, the children of Israel went out with an high hand in the sight of all the Egyptians.
He's explaining what Israel did. Remember, this is a journey. It took place after Israel left out of Egypt the 15th day of evening. Next verse.
For the Egyptians buried all their firstborn, which the Lord had smitten among them, upon their gods. Also the Lord executed judgment. And the children of Israel removed from Ramses.
Goshen. Go ahead.
And pitched in Succoth.
That's all I want. So he's explaining to you what took place after we got out of Egypt. They buried, the Egyptians buried their dead. Blah, blah, blah. We don't care. Yada, yada, yada. You understand?
Right.
Okay. So the 14th day of evening is what?
15th day.
Okay. Let's get Luke 22:1. Rumor has it, they're two separate days. I don't know how that happened. Luke 22, verse 1. Luke 22 and verse 1.
The book of Luke, chapter 22, verse 1. Now the feast of unleavened bread drew nigh, which is called the Passover.
So the feast of unleavened bread is called what?
The Passover.
The feast of unleavened bread is called the Passover. It's not two separate days. The 14th day is Passover, and the 15th day is unleavened bread. No, it's one and the same day. Mm. It's one and the same day. Now, the way it's written in Leviticus 23 could throw you off, but that's why it's important to ask questions and study. Just to be sure, just to be certain. You understand? Read again.
Now the feast of unleavened bread drew nigh, which is called the Passover.
You want the verse 7?
Verse 7. Then came the day of unleavened bread, when the Passover must be killed.
When must the Passover be killed? The 14th day at evening, which is at nighttime, which is also what?
The 15th
day. Y'all getting it? Good. That simple. Is that simple? Let's get Leviticus 23 and 33. Do I want that? Let me see if I want that. Good time, too. Leviticus 23. One second. Let me see something. One sec. Leviticus 23, verse 27. Day of Atonement, real quick.
Leviticus chapter 23, verse 27.
I'll just read down. Go ahead. 27 and down.
Also, on the 10th day of this seventh month.
On the 10th day of this seventh month. On the 10th day of this seventh month. Go ahead.
There shall be a day of atonement. It shall be an holy convocation unto you. And ye shall afflict your souls and offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord.
Go ahead.
And ye shall do no work in that same day.
In that same day, go ahead.
For it is a day of atonement. Ye shall make an atonement for you before the Lord your God.
Go ahead.
For whosoever soul it shall... for whatsoever soul it be that shall not be afflicted in that same day, ye shall be cut off from all... among his people.
Cut off means what? Need the next verse. Go and explain what that cut off means. Verse 30.
And whatsoever soul it be that doeth any work in that same day, the same soul will I destroy from among his people.
That's the cut off means. It means kill you. Next verse.
You shall do no manner of work. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations.
No manner of work means what? No manner of work means what? No manner of work means what? Y'all sound very uncertain. No manner of work means what? Sabbath. Go ahead.
You shall do no manner of work. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations in all your dwellings.
Go ahead.
It shall be unto you a Sabbath of rest.
There you go. A Sabbath of rest. Go ahead.
And ye shall afflict your souls in the ninth day of the month.
So wait, so you shall afflict your souls during the Sabbath, the ninth day of the month. Now it says ninth day here. Mm-hmm. Earlier it said tenth day. Remember that? Remember that? So the ninth, read on. Read again.
And it shall be unto you a Sabbath of rest, and ye shall afflict your souls in the ninth day of the month at even. From even unto even.
So a Sabbath is from what? Even into even. So the ninth day at even is what? That's why
day.
I said tenth day earlier. Y'all follow?
Yes, sir.
That's simple. Jump down to verse 34.
Verse 34. Speak unto the children of Israel, saying, the 15th day of this seventh month shall be the feast of tabernacles for 7 days unto the Lord.
Go ahead.
On the first day shall be an holy convocation. Ye shall do no servile work therein. 7 days ye shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. On the eighth day shall be an holy convocation unto you. Ye shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. It is a solemn assembly, and ye shall do no servile work therein.
What's that called? The Sabbath. Go ahead.
These are the feasts of the Lord, which ye shall proclaim to be holy convocations, to offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord, a burnt offering and a meat offering, a sacrifice and drink offerings, everything upon his day.
I'm sorry, I have to go back to verse 32 again, where it says ninth day of the month at even, from even to even. What's that Sabbath based upon? Ninth day at even at the month from even to even. What's that based upon? Don't call out. What is that based upon? Why from even to even? Why not from day to day, like a real Sabbath? I'm being sarcastic. I scared y'all. I'm being sarcastic. Very, very sarcastic. Yes. Why is it even to even?
Shalom, based on the creation story.
Thank you. What's the creation story? What's the creation history say?
Even to even.
Even to what?
Even to even.
Even, what's it say in the creation account? I'll give you the answer.
Evening in the day was the first day. I can't quote.
Evening in the morning was the first day. Because the end of the morning is what again?
Next day.
Right, because once the morning ends, it's what? Another evening. Day. And the day begins again.
Yes, sir.
Even to even. That's why it says even to even. You understand? So you have 12 hours of evening, then it goes into what? Day. Then 12 hours of day goes back into what? Another evening, starting a new what?
Day.
New day. Even to even. Mm-hmm. That's a day. You understand?
Sir.
Read on. What verse are we in?
We ended at verse
38. 38? Okay, go ahead. Read on.
Yeah. We read verse, we start verse 38, yeah. Ended at 37.
Go ahead.
Verse 38. Beside the Sabbaths of the Lord, and beside your gifts.
Verse 39. Jump
verse 39. Also, in the 15th day of the seventh month, when ye have gathered in the fruit of the land.
Gathered means, or in gathering. It's called tabernacles or feast of in gathering. That's a fall celebration. Feast of in, it's either called feast of tabernacles or feast of in gathering. We gathered in the fruits and crops and so forth. You understand? Go ahead.
When ye have gathered in the fruit of the land, ye shall keep a feast unto the Lord 7 days. On the first day, on the first day shall be a Sabbath, and on the eighth day shall be a Sabbath.
How do we know what a Sabbath is? How would you know what it is? Based upon what? Based upon what? Based upon what? The creation account. Go ahead.
And ye shall take you on the first.
How many Sabbaths are in the creation account? One or two? And when did he rest? When? Right. Right. Exactly. So I'll make sure everybody understands that. Okay. Read on.
Verse 40. And ye shall take you on the first day the boughs of goodly trees.
That's all I want. I don't want no more.
Okay.
Get John 7:2. Sometimes the most basic things that are most important.
The book of John, chapter 7, verse 2.
John 7, verse 2, yes.
Yeah. Now the Jews' Feast of Tabernacles was at hand.
The Jews' what?
Feast of Tabernacles was at hand.
Right, go ahead. I'm sorry. Jump to Feast of Tabernacles was at hand. Jump to verse 37 now.
Verse 37. In the last day, that great day of the feast.
What feast?
Feast of Tabernacles.
Feast of Tabernacles, not you, Ozias. He's going to call out like he's in the audience. Feast of Tabernacles. Yes. Go ahead. Read it again. 37 again.
In the last day.
The last day. Remember, the first day and last day of Tabernacles is what? Read again.
In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink.
So, you read it earlier. It says that great day. The last day was a great day. What was Passover called? The first day called the Passover called. Anyone remembers? What? A high day. Same thing. Great day, high day, same thing. Sabbaths. High Sabbath. There was a high holy day Sabbath. That's why it's called a high day or a great day. You understand? That's why it's called a high day because it was a high holy day Sabbath. Not the regular Sabbath weekly, but the high holy day Sabbath. So it's called a high day or a great day. The first one is a high holy day, a high holy day Sabbath, and the seventh day is a high day Sabbath. You understand? Let's see. Let's get Esther 10 and 12. Esther 10 and 12.
The book of Esther, chapter 10, verse 12.
Right. Chapter 10, verse 12. I'm sorry, that's in the Apocrypha.
Yeah. Oh.
The rest of Esther, I believe. The rest of Esther in the Apocrypha. Dang. Chapter 10 and 12. My fault.
Okay. Yeah. Esther in the Apocrypha, chapter 10, verse 12. So God remembered his people and justified his inheritance.
This is going back to the aftermath of Purim, from the time in which Haman's plot to kill the Jews backfired on him, and he ended up getting killed instead along with his family, thanks to Mordecai and Esther. Y'all remember that history? Purim? I hope so. If you haven't, better read it in Esther. Read our next verse.
Therefore, those days
shall... Stop. Therefore, though, emphasize on those days. Plural. Those days. Those days. You listening? Those days. Go ahead.
Those days shall be unto them in the month of Adar.
Remember that day? Month Adar. That's a Babylonian name. Adar, Tammuz, Elul, Ab, Tishri, Iyar. Because the Persians bought from the Babylonians. Because the Persians took over the Babylonian empire and maintained the names and not in gods. Just gave them Persian names. Whatever. So the month of Adar. Go ahead.
The 14th and 15th day of the same month.
So it says the 14th and 15th day of the same month. It said those days. Go ahead.
With an assembly and joy and with gladness before God according to the generations forever among his people.
So if Passover was the 14th day and 15th day, two separate days, it would be written like that. It's not written that way. Just in case you may think it is written that way, based upon Leviticus 23, because that's where the confusion comes from, let's get Esther, the actual Esther, in verse chapter 9, verse 27.
Esther, chapter 9, verse 27.
Right, watch this.
The Jews ordained and took upon them and upon their seed and upon all such as joined themselves unto them, so as it should not fail, that they would keep these 2 days.
These what?
These 2 days.
2 days. What days are those? 14th and 15th. Two separate days. That's when it's two separate days. 2 days, go ahead.
According to their writing and according to their appointed time every year.
So we celebrate Purim for 2 days. The 14th day and 15th day. You understand? Two separate days. Let's get 1 Corinthians 5 and 7. You read about Passover earlier. I want to just put emphasis on something real quick. Put some emphasis on something regarding how to keep feast days. There's one coming up, Feast of Dedication coming up. And I want to just emphasize on how to keep feast days. All who are viewing, and those of you who are here now. 1 Corinthians 5 and verse 7.
The book of 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. Purge out, therefore,
the... Verse 6.
Verse 6. Verse 5. To deliver such an one unto Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that the spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus.
So Paul was giving a judgment regarding a brother that had laid with his stepmother. He said, put that brother out and give him to the devil. So that way his sin doesn't corrupt the whole body. You keep him there, it'll corrupt everything. So he said, Paul said, put him out. Go ahead. Read on.
Your glorying is not good.
Because they did not deal rightfully judging in terms of not putting him out the first time. They didn't put him out. So Paul had to make them put him out. Go ahead.
Know ye not that a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump?
Go ahead.
Purge out, therefore, the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump.
So when you read about Passover, talk about leaven, he's saying leaven out your house represents sin. Get the sin, remove the sin that's from amongst you, that you may be a new lump. So you're not corrupted. Go ahead.
As ye are unleavened.
As ye are unleavened, there's no leaven in you. There's no sin in you. Keep sin away from you so you can remain without sin. Go ahead. Me and people amongst you. Go ahead.
For even Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Go ahead.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Let us keep the feast in front of Passover, but go ahead.
Not with old leaven.
Not with sinful sin. Go ahead. In us. Go ahead.
Neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth.
Read again.
Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness.
Our objective in Passover was to get rid of the leaven. Any sin that may be in you, he's saying get rid of it. Mortify it. Get rid of it before keeping the feast. Remove that sin that's amongst you. Go ahead.
But with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth.
Leave us it again.
Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness.
With malice and what?
And wickedness.
Don't keep the feast day with malice and wickedness. Within you or amongst you. Don't do that, he's saying. Go ahead.
But with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth.
I mean, those of you who are sincerely in the truth, who are sincerely walking with us in the doctrine that's being taught, you must keep the feast with us in sincerity and in truth. All right? Now, let's get on that note, Jude verse 8.
The book of Jude, verse 8.
Because what happens is, you have Israel that will remain with you, even in wickedness. Observing with Shalom, Most High Christ, blessed, and all that, and the feast day with you, and all that, and be in the midst of all kinds of evil and nonsense. Smiling in your face and stab you right in your back. Jude verse 8.
Jude verse 8. Likewise, also, these filthy dreamers defile the flesh. Despise dominion.
Despise being told to do. Despise order. Despise leadership. Go ahead.
And speak evil of.
Speak evil of leadership.
Dignity.
Of dignities. I'm sorry. Dignities. Jump to verse 10.
Verse 10. But these speak evil of those things which they know not.
They speak evil of things they don't understand. Regarding how to keep feast days properly. Regarding leadership. They speak evil of things they know not. Go ahead.
But what they know naturally as brute beasts. In those things they corrupt themselves. Woe unto them, for they have gone in the way of Cain.
I'm sorry, read that again, verse 10 again.
But these speak evil of those things which they know not, but what they know naturally as brute beasts.
What they know naturally mean carnally. They are carnal, they are emotional, sensual, devilish, same thing. Go ahead.
As brute beasts.
As brute means simple animals. Simple. Brute means dumb. And beast is obviously animals. Go ahead.
In those things, they corrupt themselves.
And in those things that they know carnally, naturally, emotionally, they corrupt themselves. Go ahead.
Woe unto them.
Death unto them. Go ahead.
For they have gone in the way of Cain.
And they begin to hate their brother. They begin to despise their people, despise their brother, their friends, family. In this truth, they go in the way of Cain, because remember, Cain went off in process of time. It wasn't immediate. It took time for him to Cain to become the man he became that we know him as today. It took time. It wasn't 1, 2, 3, but Cain always harbored a hatred for Abel. Always, it was always there. It just took a certain nudge to get it out of him. Read on.
And ran greedily after the error of Balaam for reward.
And then he's tying them all together. So he hated his brother and was about money. Balaam was about money. Balaam understood these people right here, the Most High is dealing with them. And I can't destroy them, but I'm going to try to find a way to do it. But what I do, I know I'm going to get paid to counsel the heathens on how to destroy them. I'm going to tell them to send women, heathen women in there. That's what I'll do, because he wanted that money so bad. Even though the Lord showed Balaam visions of us in prophecy, ruling and so forth, and he still, all for that greed, that money, he said, I'm going to make them destroy themselves. Here's an idea. Send your women in there. Because I want that money. I want that gold. I want that salt. I need that money. Because that was his God. Read on.
And perished in the gainsaying of Korah.
He perished in the gainsaying because Korah sought preeminence. Korah wanted to be head HNIC, head Negro in charge. He wanted to maintain a certain level of authority. That's what he wanted to do. So what Judah's doing is bunching all these people in together, because it's all ties in together. Because Korah hated his brother. It's all ties back to hatred. At the end of the day, it all ties into hatred at the end of the day. Balaam, because heathens hate us anyway. So Balaam, for money, sought to find a way to help the heathens destroy us. Cain hated his brother. He killed him. And Korah hated Moses. And he killed him. In fact, Balaam got us killed. Because when he brought the heathens in there, the Lord plagued us. And we got put to death. So it all ties in together for hatred and greed. Read on.
These are spots in your feasts.
Because you have people like that in the body. Even now, who are like Cain, who are like Balaam, who are like Korah, feasting with you, laughing with you, joking with you, drinking with you, smiling with you, dancing with you. Just with the spirit of Korah is in them, Balaam is in them, Cain is in them. But you won't see it right away. It takes time. Because the Balaam, they came to him, listen, man, curse Israel. He said, I can't, the Lord's dealing with them. You can't curse them? Nah, I can't curse them. What if I give you this gold? Oh, I'll figure something out. All right. I'll figure something out. Gold, silver, and diamonds? Oh, I have an idea. I'll think something up. It takes time. It wasn't right away. Read it in, verse 12 again.
These are spots in your feast of charity.
These are spots in your feast of charity. That's what I read earlier in Corinthians 5, to keep the feast with what? With sincerity and in truth. Some keep it as spots, as Cain, as Balaam, as Korah, and they do it for years. They do it for years. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 12 years. They do it for years. And then over time, Satan goes, I'm going to take him now. It's his time. It takes a while, but over time it happens. That's why you must be that's why I be teaching y'all the basics. To not be deceived by such nonsensical things. Because those who are filled with Cain, the spirit of Cain, Korah, and Balaam, will have your mind warped. Have you unwavering. That's why earlier, the first thing I brought to y'all was, be steadfast in understanding and let your word be the same. Or you will fall into the guise of Cain, Balaam's, and Korah's in here. Read again, 12.
These are spots in your feasts of charity. When they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear.
They're eating with you. They're eating leavened bread with you, eating lamb with you. They fasting with you. Keep a day of atonement with you 2 years. And hate your guts. Hate the dignity's guts. despise government while fasting. What are you fasting for? You just start this up for 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5, 6, 7 years. Read on.
Clouds they are without water.
Clouds they are. Because now when they're filled with that hatred, they're filled with that spirit of Cain, Balaam, and Korah, the understanding begins to leave them. So now they're a cloud with no understanding. Now they're just wandering around, floating around with nonsense doctrines, trying to cause confusion. Clouds without water. No, because when you see a cloud, you say, okay, it's on rain. Oh, no rain. The hell what kind of cloud is that? No rain? What's going on? Go ahead.
Carried about of winds.
Winds means doctrines. Winds of doctrines. They're not sure. They're dabbling there. They're dabbling. What happens? People have the spirit of Cain and Korah. They get put out. The leaven gets put out. They begin to wander. Now they're watching this. They're watching that. They're here. They're there. They try to bring it back to you. This is what happens. They're wandering winds. Go ahead.
Trees whose fruit withereth.
And the fruits that they had when they were within keeping holy convocations, when they were in the Feast of Charity, when they were with us, so period, in general, after a while, that fruit starts to wither. Why? Because now that hate, that spirit of Korah and Cain and Balaam starts to take root now. Starts to grow now. Okay, I feel comfortable now. All right, okay, I'm Cain, okay. This is who I was. Oh, okay. I didn't know my place. Now I know I'm Cain. Okay, now I know. It takes a while to... Like, let me give you an example. The movie The Omen with Damien. Some of y'all know about that movie, The Omen? Raise your hand. The movie The Omen. Sisters, you know what I'm talking about? The Omen, Damien. 666 in the back of the head, Esau. That is his number. Anyway, there's a young boy named Damien. He was a son of the devil. He's a son of the devil. You be John, by the way. On that note, be John 8, please. He's the son of the devil, right? And what happened was, he didn't know he was the son of the devil. He didn't know. So I think he was in military school, and the general said, listen, man, go in the mirror, look in the back of your head, you're going to see 3 6s. You're the son of the devil. You are the devil the Bible speaks of. So he goes, runs out, no! At the river. No! And he runs, and he did that after. He runs into the mirror first. You hear that hictos, lactos. Then you hear that music in the background. It's crazy, man. Music is crazy, man.
Yo, that movie music was scary as hell.
Music was scarier than the damn movie itself. Looking around, this is scary music. Why are they playing this? Anyway, he looks in the mirror, looks at his head, looks at his scalp. You see 3 6s. He runs out, screams, no! Right? Loses his mind. Shortly after. Listen, remember, he had a stepbrother. He was cool with him, all of that. So then his little brother realizes that he's the devil. He goes, he goes, get away from me.
Why?
You're the devil. He goes, don't run
Why
for me.
Me? So,
hey, don't run for me. Then he messes around. A little boy goes, he killed his brother. He came into his form just like that. All it took was that nudge. That's all it took. He was the devil the whole time, but it just took time for him to come into himself. It took a while. Now when you watch part one, he's the baby. They're trying to save him. All the devil worshipers trying to save him. They're planning, trying to make him the president. The movie's crazy. But the point is that when you watch the movie The Omen, he was good at first. And the evil things are going on around him. He didn't get it. He said, why are people dying around him? People getting cut in half in elevators. People getting killed in power plants, those crazies are going on. Birds, people get hit by trains, birds eat people's eyes in the street. It was crazy.
Hey, Deacon Ayton, I don't think Millenniums watched this as yet.
That's it for
they had Omen 1, 2, 3.
And they got a remake. They got a remake. They can watch that one. You know, the remake.
Nah, they got to watch the real old ones, man.
They should watch
it. That's the scary ones.
The
you
point
understand?
Is with the music. Hush. Latos. Anyway, when you watch it, the young boy. Get the scene. I'll show you the scene. You find the scene. I'll show you the scene.
Hey.
Don't be scared of the music, though. I might be. Don't be scared of the music.
Hoon.
I don't like that music. I don't like it.
Yo. Hey, huh? Listen.
We're going to get blocked. If the streaming you're here? Wow. We'll get blocked for streaming it. All right.
Okay.
Well, just watch the scene. I guess, I don't know what to type in. But You just look over your nose and, yeah, don't become Kane. Don't become Damien.
Hey, and listen, that 666 in the back of the head, we all know that ain't true. You understand? We know the mark of the beast is going into the philosophies, the doctrine. Yeah, yeah, the 666 going into the destruction of America, the destruction of Edom.
Right.
You know, the destruction of Esau. That's what that going into.
Right.
But the mark of the beast is not talking about that.
Right,
crap,
tattoo.
Yeah,
you know,
666.
Don't be confused. But the point is that the young boy, Damien, had to come into his form over time. It wasn't immediate. Where we at? Give me John 8. Hold that. Give me Sirach 6. Ecclesiastes 6. Because once you remove yourself or are removed from the Feast of Charity, this is what happens over time. Or you do this shit. It's done, or you do it on your own. This goes along the lines of the fruit withering. Sirach 6, verse 1. This is what happens.
The book of Sirach, chapter 6, verse 1. Instead of a friend, become not an enemy.
Don't become an enemy. And that's what happens over time. Go ahead.
For thereby thou shalt inherit an ill name.
See? You shall inherit an ill name based upon your actions towards your friends. Mm. In time, a snake, a viper, a serpent. These are terms that you receive later on in time based upon your actions. Go ahead.
Shame and reproach. Even so shall a sinner that hath a double tongue.
Sinners speak in contradictory terms. They don't make sense when they talk. They'll say one thing and they'll say something else. It makes no sense. One contradicts the other. It's Satan. They're filled with demons. So each demon's arguing over power, what to say. Like the movie Split. The dude talking, but that's my Split. That's what happens over time. You stop making less sense. That's why I said that the talk of fools is irksome and without sense. Because they start rambling. Ah, blah, blah. You can't get a word in because they all bugged out their mind. Start looking real sick under the eyes. Look, you see demons in people. You start to see after a while. They look sickly. They don't look right. Y'all laughing. We've seen it for years. Like the movie, give you a perfect example. Oh. With Lord of the Rings. With Wormtongue. Yeah. He was in the king's ear. The king looked all weak and frail. Then when he got rid of the worm tongue, his health came back. He looked better. Took a while, but that was over time.
Yep, and also devil advocate, you remember?
And devil's advocate also.
Yeah.
With the wife.
Yeah.
With his wife. Yeah.
His wife could have seen the demons.
She could see the demons. She got sick too. Read on.
Extol not thyself in the counsel of thine own heart.
Exalt not yourself in the counsel of your own heart. I know this. I built this. I built that. I'm head nigga in charge. Me.
No.
Stone out yourself. Go ahead.
No, let me tell you all something. Now, the Most High brought all of us together in this nation, right? He bring in some of us before others. You understand? Now, me and Aiton been in this from the beginning. And whatever we did in this truth, I can't go and say, I built IUIC, or you understand, because it's us working as a unit, and whatever I did in this truth, guess what? I can't take the glory for myself. It's the spirit of the Most High that came upon me to do the things that I did. You understand? Some things I did that I didn't even know what I was doing. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I just got it done. I just did it. The Most High used me as his vessel to do it. That's why we always give honor and glory to who? To the Most High. Everything I did in this truth, everything I done, all of us do, is not because we want to do it or not. It's the Most High use our spirit to do these things. So we can't take honor and glory for that. Oh, I build this. I build that. No. You understand? The Most High brought us all together, and he put the spirit on certain of us to get his work done, to do what he wants us to do. You understand? So we got to give the Most High God the honor and glory for that. None of us should never come up out of our mouth and say, oh, I did this and I did that in IUIC because you came in before other men and you was here when we was small in numbers. No, The Most High used us as a whole to build this right here. Each of us had a role to play. You understand? It's not no one man put this up. This ain't a one man show. We keep telling you all that. IUIC is not a one man show. You understand? IUIC is all you brothers and sisters that's putting in your brick throughout the four corners of the earth. That's IUIC. You know, IUIC is not a one man show. We keep telling you all that, man. You know, so you all get that in your head. You brothers and sisters that put in work in IUIC and did stuff here in the truth. Listen, you go off and you be wicked, all of that going to be forgotten, man. Everything you did, every work you put in, you turn out to be the devil down the line. You grow into that Damien spirit. Listen, everything you did, it's going to be forgotten in the sight of the Most High. And that's what the scripture says, man. You know? So it don't matter what you did in the past, what you did in the future, what you're doing now, what you're doing in the present. That's what you got to worry about. What are you doing in the present? You understand? You brothers that in here, whatever you put in, whatever work you put in this truth, you understand? You go off and you being evil. Listen, everything you did, the Most I forget about it, man. You understand? You could have been in this truth for 15, 20 years. Everything you put in, the Most High, you fall off and you go back into some wickedness, Most High going to forget everything, man. You know? You got what you're looking for? Yeah, man. So nothing should be coming out of no brother's mouth that, oh, I build IUIC. You understand what I'm saying? That shouldn't be coming out of nobody's mouth. You understand? Nobody's mouth, because we got to give the Most High God. That's who we give all the honor and glory to. You understand? That's who we give the Most High all the glory to. Right, you ready?
Yeah,
man. So you brothers and sisters, get your mind right. We got people amongst us that, as I said, we got some brothers and sisters that put in a lot of work, man. You understand? But because of the work they put in, you think they could turn around, oh, I did this for IUIC. I did that. No, you did it for the Lord, man. You understand? And the Lord used you to put in that work. It's not about you. It's not about none of us. Understand that. You know, the Most High going to use us. You know?
Get 2 Corinthians 10 and 17.
2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 17. But he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord.
You're going to glory, you glory in the Lord. Give all praises to the Lord, not you, not yourself. Read the next verse. Go and say it.
For not he that commendeth himself is approved.
You're not approved if you commend yourself. You're not approved if you commend only yourself. Go ahead.
But whom the Lord commendeth.
Whom the Lord commendeth. And that's through your actions, not through your words. Lord don't care about that. He's quoting Jeremiah 9. That's what I was looking for. Jeremiah 9:24 is where he's quoting from. Give me 1 Kings 18 and 21. No, I'm sorry. Sirach 6. I'm sorry. I was Sirach 6. Who was that there? Go back there. Please ask us Sirach and 6. Sirach 6 and 1.
The book of Sirach, chapter 6, verse 1.
Sirach 6, verse 2.
Verse 2. Extol not thyself in the counsel of thine own heart.
Extol not yourself in the counsel of your own mind. Go ahead. Don't exalt yourself. Commend yourself. Go ahead.
That thy soul be not torn in pieces as a bull straying alone.
That your soul be not torn in pieces by who? The devil. Like a bull that strays from the herd and ends up alone. Now you torn apart. Now you're in every wind of doctrine. You're all over the damn place. Now you're speaking in circles, talking in contradictions, rambling. Go ahead.
Thou shalt eat up thy leaves.
You shall what?
Thou shalt eat up thy leaves.
You shall eat up your leaves. Whatever growth you had in your knee, growth you had coming from you, in this truth, you shall eat it up. They start falling off. I mean, leaves start falling off, it's dying. Go ahead.
And lose thy fruit.
And you lose your fruit. The fruit withereth. That's in Jude. Go ahead.
And leave thyself as a dry tree.
And leave yourself as a dry tree. Meaning dead. No nourishment, no water, nothing. Go ahead.
A wicked soul shall destroy him that have it.
A wicked soul shall destroy him that has it. Go ahead.
And shall make him to be laughed to scorn of his enemies.
And you will bring to yourself an ill name, a shame, and a reproach. You will destroy your own self by your own actions, being torn apart, saying to yourself, exalting yourself. Go to 1 Kings 18. So those of you amongst us who are confused, don't know what's going on, you lost and confused, this is what I have for you. We're still listening and following behind the spirits of Cain, Balaam, and Korah. 1 Kings 18 and 21.
The book of 1 Kings, chapter 18, verse 21.
This is the question that Elijah had asked Israel when they were involved in idolatry in the time of Jezebel. Read on.
And Elijah came unto all the people and said, how long halt ye between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him.
You follow the Lord. You believe he's God, you follow him. Go ahead.
But if Baal...
You're going to follow people like Korah, Balaam, and Cain. Go ahead.
Then follow him.
Follow them. Make a choice. Don't stay. Don't be lukewarm. If you don't... Listen. You cannot be caught between two opinions. You cannot serve two. It doesn't work that way. Many amongst us who are with us are not really with us. They're not really here. They're not here. They're here, but not here. Because they're halted between two opinions. So choose who you will serve, the Lord or the devil. It's one or the other. Someone got to be the devil. That's the way of the world. Someone got to be Satan. Good is set against evil. There's no good and good. That's how the world works. It's balance. 1 Corinthians 14:33. If you are caught between two opinions, here's why.
1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 33. For God is not the author of confusion.
God is not the author of those who are halt between two opinions. Two opinions means you're confused. God didn't authorize that. That's the devil. There's no, I'm confused, I'm righteous. No, you're confused because you got the devil on you. Read again.
For God is not the author of confusion.
Go ahead.
But of peace.
But of what?
But of peace.
Of peace. Not of strife, arguing. No. Of peace. Give me Hebrews 5. We're going to fight to defend that peace. Hebrews 5 and verse 12.
The book of Hebrews, chapter 5, verse 12. 1 second. For when for the time you ought to be teachers.
Read verse 11.
Verse 11.
Then we're going to wrap it up soon. Wrap it up in verse 14. Go ahead.
Of whom we have many things to say and hard to be uttered.
No, verse 11, let us labor therefore. Oh. Let us labor therefore. Verse 11. Where you at? 4, verse 11.
Oh, Hebrews 4. Okay, so you're in 5. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 11. Let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief.
I'm sorry, unbelief. I said 5, right? I'm sorry, I meant 4. 4 verse 11, I'm sorry.
Okay. Let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief.
That's what happens over time. You fall under the example of unbelief. When you fall under, Korah didn't believe. Cain did not believe. Balaam was a heathen, so we got to exclude him. But between the two, Cain and Korah did not believe in God at all. Balaam didn't either. He was a heathen, but the Lord showed him everything. Showed him our glory, all that. He's like, I don't care about that stuff. I want money. I'm about that money. The hell with that. The visions you show me of them being great people and wise and their Messiah, who I'm never going to see, be close to. I understand all of that, but I'm trying to get paid. I ain't got time for that. And many of you, God forbid, in this room, are the same as Balaam was. Yeah, that Bible's good and all, but I'm trying to get this money. I'm trying to get paid. I'm trying to pay these bills. I ain't got time for that God stuff. I need my pockets filled. Many of y'all in here like that. And many of you, because you're like that, are halt between two opinions. So you stick around. But over time, that fruit will wither. And you'll wither out and fade off into the wind, whatever. So it's inevitable. You can't stay that way forever. in the process of time, like Damien, you will go off. Just a matter of how Satan pushes you to do it. Read again.
Let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief.
Read on.
For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword.
Because the law will push you out. Because the word of God cannot remain a malicious soul. That's what Solomon said. It cannot remain in a malicious soul. It will get rid of you. It will flee deceptive spirits. And we'll see it in your face. Whether you're in here or you leave out of here. We'll see it in time. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Piercing, even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart.
That's why people usually leave out of here. They create an excuse to leave. Like, oh, I heard chicken is unlawful. I'm out of here. I'm leaving. I heard the sky is red. Ah, I'm leaving. Listen, just go.
Oh, I heard leadership extorting people.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm leaving. I saw that this week.
Illuminati. Oh. Listen, man.
Oh, this one dude said we are Illuminati, Freemasons, and all right. Type of crazy
and the elder
stuff.
Elder has boots that can help him float. He can levitate. Remember that?
Israel is
the
crazy,
elder is
man.
Media man, apparently.
You know, so these things happen for brothers and sisters that are looking for excuses that don't believe, they going to be out. You
seaweed
understand?
Is lawful. It's unlawful. Leave. We can't drink juice no more. We can't breathe. We got to use our noses only. That'll use our mouth. Listen, go, get out. It's a sin to breathe. Breathe through your eyes. Read verse 13, please.
Verse 13. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and opened unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do.
Right, verse 12.
Verse 12.
From chapter 5, verse 12.
Chapter 5. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 12. For when for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again,
uh-huh,
which be the first principles of the oracles of God,
uh-huh,
and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong
meat.
That's
why we emphasize on deep basics. You have to understand basic things, like how to count the day. That's why I went over something basic today, how to count the days. 14th day of the evening is the 15th day. If you can't understand that, you shouldn't be teaching anyone any kind of milk, right, any time of day, whether night, morning, afternoon. You can't teach that. You understand that? You shouldn't be teaching nobody a damn thing at all. Don't make sense. Read again.
For when for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat.
You need to learn basic things first before you teach somebody anything. Go ahead.
For everyone that useth milk.
Anyone that uses milk.
Is unskillful in the word of
righteousness. Unskillful in the word. Go ahead.
In the word of righteousness, for he is a babe.
You don't know anything. You are a babe. You don't know a damn thing. You're a babe. You shouldn't be teaching anything. You just know milk, and that's it. Go ahead.
But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age.
Those who have experience, time, years, age. Full age, been through things, been to war, go out in the streets, jeopardize their lives, go to camp, deal with their people face to face in dangerous areas, countries and lands. That's full age, not homebodies sitting down sipping tea. Keep the commandments, people. Listen, milk. That's milk. Stop. Stop it now. Milk. Those who are full age, going out there, doing the work, soldiers of the Lord. Gathering the people together, taking time, working collectively as one, guiding the people, meaning making huge decisions for the nation. That's full age experience and time to do that. Don't just take 1 day, 2 months to do that. You can't replicate that in a couple of weeks or months. You're gone on your own. That's not happening. And we've seen it fail time and time again. When I mentioned the scripture where it says, he that's first his own cause, that wasn't damage control. That's facts. That's from experience of seeing people walk out the door and fail. Even people leave other camps outside of our own. They'll leave and do their own thing. They flop off into the wind because they weren't serious. They're just trying to prove some point that they couldn't maintain it. So it's facts. It's not opinion. It's facts. But read on. The strong meat belongeth.
But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil.
To discern both good and evil. Both good and evil. Because they've been through it. They've been through enough to know how to discern spirit situations, how to guide matters, whether small or large. Because they've been through it enough to know how to guide the nation properly. All right? That's it.
Now they will see the treatment of God. We are not black men, we are the Israelites.
That's right.
It's so hard to serve God. And why would I say that I'm a Jew? It's so odd. For years I've been walking around saying that I'm a black man. I ain't saying that no more. It's so wrong, man.
This is Bishop Nathaniel of Israel United in Christ. Please subscribe to our YouTube channels. Stay up to date with our latest events, music, and classroom lessons. IUIC plans to continue visiting different countries where this gospel has not been preached before. IUIC needs your help in pushing this truth. So join us. Subscribe to our Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and podcast, and stay up to date with us. For more information, please visit www.israelunite.org.